Hello friends, welcome to NIO Studio once again. Myself, Dr. Yukti Sharma from Department of Education, University of Delhi. Today I am going to discuss with you about children with special needs, locomotor impairment and multiple impairments. We'll start with locomotor impairment. As you can see, there is a news item of 21st March 2018 and this says that government agrees to amend rules to admit people with disabilities so that they can take graduate and postgraduate medical courses. Now, according to the amended provisions, the 21 types of disabilities, that includes locomotor disability also, they can now take the graduate and postgraduate courses in a medical course. So, we start with this positive note. When we are giving place to these people in the society, they are like us and we are preparing a society for them. Why not? We should do the same in our classrooms. And the first step towards that is we should understand as teachers what is locomotor impairment. Now, for that, I have taken the example of Stephen Hawking, a great theoretical physicist whom we all know, who recently left us. He suffered from a rare motor neuron disease which is called amyotrophic lateral sclerosis. Now, what is this disease? As we know, there are two kinds of neurons or nerve cells in our body. One are the sensory neurons who take the information from our body part to the brain. So, if I touch this table, the smoothness of the table is communicated through our sensory nerve cells to the brain and the brain tells that the table is smooth. On the other hand, if the table was sharp, the brain will send back the message and tell that I should remove my hand because it is having some sharp things on it and I may get hurt. Now, this work of bringing information from the brain to the body parts to my hand is done by a group of nerve cells which are called motor nerve cells or motor neurons. In this particular disease, these nerve cells or neurons, they start dysfunctioning and therefore what happens, the information does not come from the brain to the body parts. Now, it's not only about hands, it can be any body part, hands, legs, any other body part that you can think of, even the internal organs which do involuntary functions. So, what happens, the body of the person is not in the person's control anymore. So, you can imagine the state of the person. The brain is functioning to its maximum capacity, but the body is not with the person. The second thing I wanted to tell you about Stephen Hawking is that in 1963, when he was at the age of 21, at that time he diagnosed this disease. And by late 1960s, his physical condition worsened to such an extent, I mean within 7 years, that he started using crutches and he lost his ability to write also. And finally, by the end of 1960s, he had to be wheelchair ridden. Now, two things which we can learn from this example is, one, locomotor impairment doesn't simply mean amputation of a particular organ. It can be because of any reasons. It can be any kind of helplessness that a person feels in his or her body. It can be any kind of immobility that a person feels. And therefore, it has several reasons. This is one case that I have discussed. The second learning is that it can happen to any of us at any phase of our life. So, not necessarily a person is born with it. It can happen at any phase of life. This is important to understand. And that is why we need to have universal designs in our infrastructure, in our learnings. Now, we come to the Rights of Persons with Disabilities Act, what it says about locomotor disability. It says that it's a person's inability to execute distinctive activities associated with movement of self and objects resulting from affliction of musculoskeletal or nervous system or both. That's what we discussed just now. It could be simply musculoskeletal where your hand got, somebody's hand got cut or got amputated or somewhere got paralyzed, or it could be because of nervous system. So, some problem with nervous system and the nervous system is not giving the signals to the body, or it could be because of both also. So, according to this act, it includes the following. The first is the leprosy cured person, means a person who has been cured of leprosy but is suffering from one, loss of sensation in hands and feet as well as loss of sensation in the eye and the eyelid, but with no manifest deformity. Extreme physical deformity as well as advanced age, which prevents him or her from understanding, from undertaking any gainful occupation, and the expression leprosy cured shall construed accordingly. The second is cerebral palsy, means a group of non-progressive neurological condition affecting body movements and muscular coordination caused by damage to one or more specific areas of the brain, usually occurring before or during or shortly after birth. So this is where the nervous system is getting affected. Dwarfism means a medical or a genetic condition which results in an adult height of 4 feet 10 inches or less. Muscular dystrophy means a group of hereditary genetic muscle disease that weakens the muscles that move the human body, and persons with multiple dystrophy have incorrect and missing information in the genes which prevents them from making the proteins they need for healthy muscles. It is characterized by progressive skeletal muscle weakness, defects in muscle proteins, and the death of muscle cells and tissues. Acid attack victims means a person disfigured due to violent assaults by throwing of acid or similar corrosive substance. Now coming to who are children with locomotor impairment in my classroom? How will I come to know? One is they look physically different but have same psychological makeup. So we have to first point we have to understand is they are psychologically similar to other children. It's only that they look physically different. So they can also understand as other children do, although they may be looking very different to you. Second, their body is in a state that hinders them from participating in school activities that require that require physical movement. So it's because of their body condition that they are not able to do the certain activities, but we should also understand at the same time that how can we modify the activities that they can participate. So in our current activities they may not be able to participate because of their physical movement. Third is maybe using crutches or wheelchair for mobility. So if they are using any of these, then it's obvious that they have some physical problem. Maybe having some kind of physical deformity because of any of the reasons. Lack of sensation or strength in hands, unable to write and have psychomotor issues, lack of sensation or strength in legs, limp or unable to walk or move independently, weakness in the muscle, unable to sit erect or keep their neck erect, less or lack of control over their physical body. So any of these, if you see in any of your children, it means that they have some kind of locomotor impairment. What can we do as teachers for children with locomotor impairment? Early identification of the locomotor impaired person is very important. And therefore, some of the important signals that you as teachers can see is, one, any deviation or slowness in child's developmental milestones. Now, you as a teacher understand what all the child should have achieved by now as per the age. So, if you feel that there is any deviation or slowness, then you should talk to the parents or seek some medical help to understand that what could be the possible causes of these deviations or slowness. Excessive stiffness or floppiness of the child. Now that can also be because the child is not able to move the body in a smooth way. Use of limbs of only one side of the body. So if the child is using only one side of the body and not using the other side, that also shows that child has some kind of locomotor impairment. Difficulty or abnormality observed when the child is asked to do the following. If you tell the child to lift the arm over the head and the child is not able to bring the arm over the head, then that can be that the child is suffering from locomotor impairment. Or you tell the child to pick a small object lying in front of him or her, which is well in reach of the child, and the child is not able to do so, then also the child is having some impairment. Pick a stone from the ground or walk a few steps or run a short distance. So any of these small activities you can do with your children as part of your classroom activity. And if the child is not able to do, for that child you need to further see what can be done. You could also try to assess that child separately, individually, and have one-to-one interaction to understand that why the child couldn't do certain things which other children were able to do. Difficulty in standing up from the sitting position. Now, that's another factor that can show that the child is having locomotor impairment, and for that again we need to be patient to understand that it's not that the child may be playing a prank with us. The child actually has some issue with standing up from the sitting position, takes time while doing so, and therefore we should try to see the possible cause and figure out whether the possible cause is locomotor impairment. Range of motion of joint decreased or excessively increased. Absence of limb in part or full. They all come under locomotor impairment. Use of appliances like stick, crutches, wheelchair, tricycle. Now, all this implies to a teacher that the child is having some kind of locomotor impairment. Ensure that all the classrooms and other spaces in the school are accessible. Now, what we can do in such situation is, the first thing is that we should look at our classroom. If a child with crutches enters the classroom, or the child with sitting in a wheelchair enters the classroom, is my class having enough space that they are able to move whichever way they want to move? They are moving with crutches, they are moving in wheelchairs, but is my class having that space? So that is the first thing I can do as a teacher. Other than that, I have to also see that there are other spaces in the schools where the child has to go for certain activities. So, are they also accessible to them, whichever way they are coming? But accessibility in the school and in its spaces is very important for specifically for children with locomotor impairment. Classroom furniture should have space for wheelchair. Now, the desks that we have in the school, if they are very small, the child will not be able to sit with the desk using the wheelchair while sitting on the wheelchair. So, the furniture should be broad enough so that the wheelchair could be accommodated in that. The height of the workstation, especially when we are working in a computer lab or in a science laboratory, our workstations generally are such where the wheelchair may not fit. So, we should have specific workstations which are lower in height, and the child who is sitting on the wheelchair can sit and do the activity or the laboratory experiment or the computer work that the child is supposed to do. For students with hand function limitations, the children who have problem in writing because of some problem in or some impairment in the hand, they should be allowed to take a note taker who can write on behalf of the child. Provision of extra time, we all know that it is there in most of the exams. So, it's a provision for them. Instead of 3 hours, they can take 4 hours to write the same exam, but they are writing the same exam. That is what is important. They are writing they are doing the same assignment as other children are. So, it's not an issue if they are using extra time. That is their need. And therefore, provision of extra time should be given as teachers also. As teachers, we should also give it and use this provision in the classroom. It should not remain for some main exams only. Accept the tape recording of written assignments or exams. Now, if instead of writing, they want to verbally record it and give it to you, then I think as a teacher, we should accept it because it is equally valid. We want them to learn the concepts. It's important they are understanding, comprehending, articulating the concepts. Now, whichever way they are communicating this understanding to us, it should be acceptable to us as teachers. Should be allowed to give exams orally. So, similarly, if they want to speak out and give the exam instead of writing, or certain part of exam they want to speak out and certain they can write, then that also should be allowed. So, basically, there should be flexibility in our system, in our assessment, in our teaching, so that these children, their needs could be addressed. Option of giving exam on the computer should be available. Now, because now we are so technology savvy, we have computers in most of our schools, even in the rural far-flung areas, we are having this provision. So, if the provision is there, then why not allow them to write exam on the computer? Now, we come on to the other category, which is the multiple impairment. I start this by taking the example of Helen Keller. Now, you all are familiar, must be familiar with her, because the movie Water is based on her life. where the girl has been shown to have lack of sight as well as lack of hearing ability. So Helen Keller is actually that personality on whom this movie was made. She lost her senses of sight and hearing when she was around 6 years old. So it was not from birth. And the picture shows her with her mentor, whose name was Annie Sullivan, who taught her to understand and write the words. So the first word that she is teaching her is doll. She brought a gift for her and it was a doll, and she is trying to tell her that what I have brought to her, brought for you, is a doll. Now, because she can't see and because she can't hear also, so how to communicate? Now, what she is doing is, she is using a strategy where she is placing the object in one hand while manually she is spelling the word in the other hand. So the spellings are basically, she is writing the spelling of doll on the other hand, and by the movement of the teacher's fingers, the child is trying to understand the shape, that is the shapes that are written, and through those shapes the child is understanding the word. So you can understand how difficult it is when there are multiple impairments. So multiple impairment means where there is a combination of impairment in a child. Now this combination can be any combination. In this particular case, it is visual impairment and hearing impairment, which makes the situation all the more complex. But that doesn't mean that we don't have alternatives for it. As you can see, her teacher, Helen's teacher, has evolved a strategy for her, and she could make her communicate, and later Helen became, herself became a social leader, and she taught the blind children as well as deaf children. Now, understanding multiple impairment. One is, a single type of impairment also causes others, and therefore a person can have more than one impairment also. Secondly, it's particularly true where disease or trauma is severe. So if there is a disease or trauma which is very severe, or an impairment also which is very severe, it can cause other impairments also. Deaf blindness is one commonly identified combination. Neither profoundly deaf nor legally blind, but are both visual and hearing impaired to the extent that strategies for deafness or blindness alone won't work. So therefore, some more alternative strategies have to be thought about where the person has both kind of impairment. People with developmental disabilities may have a combination of mental and physical impairments that result in substantial functional limitations in three or more areas of major life activity. Diabetes, which can cause blindness, also often causes loss of sensation in the fingers, and this makes braille or raised lettering impossible to read. So the person is blind but can't use embossed materials, because diabetes has also led to nerve problem, and that nerve problem leads to loss of sensation in the fingers. So the person is blind also and is not able to use the sense of touch also. So therefore there is another level of complexity that needs to be addressed in some other way. Cerebral palsy, often accompanied by visual impairments, hearing and language disorders, or by cognitive impairments. Now, according to the Rights of Persons with Disabilities, RPWD Act 2016, multiple disabilities means more than one of the above specified disabilities, including deaf blindness, which means a condition in which a person may have combination of hearing and visual impairments, causing severe communication, developmental and educational problems. Children with multiple impairment. Now, when we look at children with multiple impairment, one thing we need to understand is they are very heterogeneous group. They are very heterogeneous in their characteristics. Why? Because there are different combinations in which a person or a child can be impaired. And therefore, their capabilities are going to be very different and very, very unique. Hence, they have to be individually understood sometimes by the teacher. We can't place them in one group and say that the group needs are met, so their need would also be met. For example, if you have a blind And as we took the example just now, and a person who has low sensation in the hands. Now, if this blind group is kept, child is kept with other blind children, obviously that child's needs won't be met because the child has other needs also. And the ways in which we are addressing the needs of a blind person will not address this child's need because this child has also lost the sense of touch. So the strategies which are used for one impairment not necessarily would be used in that case where this impairment is accompanied by some other impairment. And so their learning needs altogether change. Second is share some attributes but have. So what I just discussed, they are sharing some attributes with other children also, but still they will have some specific unique needs which are their own. Combination of impairments have chronic medical needs also. This also we have to take care that because generally this happens in severe cases, therefore there are some specific medical needs also in which we need to be in touch with the medical professionals. Often exhibit motor development delays, difficulties with mobility, sitting, standing, then struggle to communicate their wants and needs, to freely move their body, to access and engage with their world, and also to learn abstract concepts and ideas. So they are generally struggling with understanding abstracts and concepts, ideas, because they have limitations because of more than one reasons. Causes of multiple impairment could be social, environmental and physical. And they generally include brain injury or infection before, during or after birth. Growth or nutritional problems, it could be prenatal, perinatal or it could be postnatal, means before birth, during conception or after. Causes of multiple impairment others are abnormalities of chromosomes and genes, birth long before the expected birth date, which is called as extreme prematurity, poor maternal diet and absent or minimal health care, drug abuse during pregnancy including alcohol intake and smoking. Now what can we do as teachers for children with multiple impairment? The first thing is that we need to consider the special needs of each child individually. We have to accept that each of these child would have different needs. We just can't group them with other children and assume that their needs are being met. Second is provision of necessary support to meet specific needs. Where a special educator is required, where a medical professional is required, we have to identify necessary support also from these people. Coordination with other professionals and parents to create learning opportunities for them. Similarly, we have to coordinate with these professionals as well as their parents so that we can plan specific individualized learning opportunities for them. Individualized curriculum also per their needs has to be designed because these children may not be getting represented in the present curriculum. So we as teachers, if we feel that we can modify the curriculum to some extent so that it becomes understandable for them, it should be done at our level also. Specialized teaching strategies, as we took the examples of Helen's mentor, similarly we also need to see and observe that what strategies would work for a particular child in my classroom who is having multiple impairment. Now for that we need to discuss definitely with the special educators who are more informed about these strategies, and in interaction with them we need to plan some strategies for them. Assistive technology intervention, appropriate devices which they require, that should be made available for them so that they are able to engage with other children also. So we conclude this session through the following points. One is that children with locomotor impairment are those who are unable to do certain functions associated with the movement of the body. And we have already seen that the causes and the reasons are many. But this is precisely what we mean by them. Most important response to them should be making the spaces and the resources accessible to them. How they can themselves independently reach out to the spaces and the resources. That is what is most important. Provisioning in terms of alternatives should be done. Provisioning here means that we should have an ample of alternatives for them in the classroom. Instead of writing what they can do, they can submit orally or they can submit a recording. Similarly, in case of children with multiple impairment, they are those who have more than one impairment. And therefore, we have already discussed that they are a very heterogeneous group. Although the group is very heterogeneous, but each child is very unique in that group. And therefore, we need to have specialized teaching strategies and assistive technologies for them, as well as support from all the professionals who are concerned with the child, who the child needs. So, I hope this session could communicate as much as it could about children with multiple impairments and children with locomotor impairments. These are a few readings that you can look for if you are more interested in reading about these children, and also for some practices that you would like to implement in your classroom. So, all the best to you, and see you again in some other session. Thank you.